We're going to talk about anger, because we all have a few things we can be angry about. I have a few just from this morning to be angry about. And that was just on my drive here. Right? I want to put up a picture that I found this week. Tate, you have it?
Oh, yeah.
I think that's a great product. I don't have to say anything to anyone, but I can just leave it there as a kind little note on the windshield. That just shares the love of Jesus, yes? The fact that it's just a car is sharing the love of Jesus, possibly. I saw this and I found this really funny. Because how many times have we gotten to our car, particularly at the Shawnee Mall, where I still do not understand why those parking spots are so narrow when we live in Oklahoma with so many trucks. Doesn't make sense. And you pull into these parking spots and you're sure you're going to hit someone or someone's going to hit you. And you get outside of the mall and somebody is just parked ridiculously. Well, if I could just tell them off, if I could just give them a piece of my mind, I'm just going to get parking. There. Yes? All right. So we can't do that. That's not really nice. I want to tell you another story. Tate was driving down the highway and he got over to Ireland Grand Casino. And he got over there and he's, you got one car side by side. He's in the left lane. The other person's in the right lane. And he's trying to pass and not go too high over the speed limit, because he doesn't drive like I do. And so he's just creeping along, and he's got the kids in the car, and then there's a person behind him who just can't wait. They're just impatient. And so they ride up right on the tail end. Anybody ever do that to you?
Every day.
This morning. Yeah. And you think to yourself, yeah, because that's going to motivate me to move. Right? It's going to motivate me to tap my brake pedal, not motivate me to move, maybe. So this person kept getting closer and closer, and Tate had an opportunity. He said, I could press my pedal and I could play this game for a while. I had to go all the way to the city. This could last a good 30 minutes. He said, I just decided I didn't want to deal with it that day. So as soon as I just laid on the gas and zoomed past the other person and moved on over to the other lane. Well, the person in the car that was riding him came up beside him, made the look, probably a few other things. And then drove on past, and then Tate moved back into the left-hand lane. As they're driving, all of a sudden, the kids notice something is happening in the car ahead of them. The window rolls down, the driver's side window, and all of a sudden, a fist goes out the window, and the hand opens. And out of the hand drops a handful of coins. So the coins hit the pavement at 75, let's be real, 80 miles an hour, and bounces back and hits the windshield in the car. And then the hand comes back out and drops another fistful of coins. And then one more. And the question is, how much does our anger really cost us? Literally. Sometimes our anger costs us a lot. To be so angry, to be in such a hurry that day that it was literally worth throwing your money on the road to cause damage to someone else's personal property, that's an anger issue. And we see that not just in the increasing road rage that we see across the country. We see that in the workplace. We see that in the church. We see that in our homes, in our families, in our schools. We don't know how to relate to each other anymore. This week, Aiden was asking Tate and I a question on Sunday night. He said, I got to go to school tomorrow, and my homework was to ask you guys what you remember of September 11th. And we both inhaled a bit, and then exhaled and said, well, where do we start? We can tell you we can remember the exact outfits we wore, we can remember where we were, and what happened, and how it happened. And so we shared those stories with him. And we started talking more about how sorry we were, because the world that we had experienced prior to September 11th, our children would never know. And what happened on that day was a lot of things, but what I'm really talking about today is the anger that would become what our country is now swimming in. That for a moment, in the midst of tragedy, we could put all of the garbage aside, all of our differences aside for just a moment, and we could gather together as a people. And you saw people running into buildings and saving people's lives and risking their lives, and the goodness of humanity rose to the top in the midst of the most horrendous of humanity. And at the same time, we said, we'll never forget, we'll never forget, we'll never forget. And I think we did forget a while ago. We forgot that we're one people. I think as Christians forgot a long time ago, we have one God, one kingdom, one body of Christ. We are so focused on our divisions. And so what we do is we continue to focus on what makes us different and what makes us angry at the other person. We put other people down and we mock them, and we focus so much on our fears instead of on our hopes that it's just more comfortable to be afraid. And that's when it dawned on me. We live in such a terrified, scared world. And that's the world our children are growing up in. Because we don't trust each other anymore. We don't go next door to meet our neighbors. We don't just blindly, sometimes that's wise, we just open the Halloween candy on Halloween. We don't know what we have warnings on the TV, what people are handing out to our children. We don't trust what's happening in the schools, and we don't trust our doctors. We don't trust anybody. We've become more and more isolated since September 11. We've forgotten that the strength that we had that day wasn't our anger. The strength that we exuded that day was our love and compassion. We have to find a better way to be strong. Anger is how we pretend we're strong. Anger is how we pretend we have control. Anger is how we pretend that we have a say-so in the difficult things of life. If I can be angry at you, then I can hopefully maybe manipulate you or control you. If I can speak evilly about you and cause you harm, well, see, look what I do. You know, I've heard things like, oh, they better not cross me. They don't know what they're dealing with. And my children say that every morning before the coffee comes. We are so afraid that we don't trust each other. We automatically assume the person is out for wrong. We join groups now across the country, and we had before, but really across the country. We join groups now where we can share our hatred of other groups and celebrate our hatred of people and our fear of people. Hate groups have been on the rise across the country since September 11th. Multiple hate groups. And there, in that moment, I realized how damaging our anger really, really is. Last week we talked about anxiety, and a lot of our anger, honestly, stems from anxieties we haven't dealt with. Fears we have not confronted, wounds we have not become introspective about, conversations we've not had. Instead of talking to one another and working through our conflicts, we become conflict avoidant. We are the most passive-aggressive people I have ever seen. Except on a football day. Somehow we're aggressive then. In other ways. But when it comes to actually dealing with relationships, we are either aggressive or we're passive-aggressive. And you might have recognized that maybe in your own life. Well, I'm just not going to talk to them. That'll show them. Does that work? It never works. It doesn't work. I'm just going to talk behind their back and run them down. Does that work? It doesn't. Here's the thing. What other people choose to use as words and behavior says everything about them and not you. So if somebody's using their anger and their malice and their untended to emotions to project hatred towards you, and violence, verbal violence or physical violence towards you, that doesn't have to do with you. That has to do with them. God talks all over the Bible about when we don't deal with our anger, what happens? It begins to bubble up, right? It's just like anxiety. We don't deal with our emotions. We just don't want to deal with that. And yet, God and Jesus and Paul and the disciples all said, you got to deal with this stuff. You can't keep running away and sticking your head in the sand. You got to confront it. You got to heal it. Don't, wouldn't you rather be in healed relationships or at least be at peace than to be in relationships where you're constantly at war? That's not the life that Christ died to give us, to be constantly at war with one another. So, somebody that I enjoy listening to on occasion is a gentleman you might have heard of as Deepak Chopra. Anybody ever heard of Deepak? I don't know, something about when he talks, I'm just kind of like lulled to a different place. But he was talking to Hoda Kotb, because I love the Today Show, so sorry, not sorry. And they were doing an interview, and Hoda said, you know, what do you think of all these people who are offended all the time? And Deepak is this super calm guy, and he just says, what a waste of life. You know, if you're offended all the time, he said, it's probably because you have an overinflated sense of self. Well, that one hurt, didn't it? I know, it hurt when I heard it too. An overinflated sense of self, yeah. When we suddenly interpret everything as somebody's offending me, somebody's harming me, somebody's doing something against me, when 9 times out of 10 it has nothing to do with us. But then it catapults us into anger, and then we're angry at everybody around us, and the next thing we know, we're dropping coins out our window. And we don't know how to come there. We end up in arguments with people we deeply love. I talked to people who, I got into an argument with my spouse. Oh, okay, well, let's talk about that. Well, I didn't feel heard, and then it was back and forth, and before I knew it, I was just screaming, and I could see red, and I was raging, and then I hit them. I would never hit them. I can't believe I did that. I have so much shame and guilt. You know, anger leads us to do things and to say things we might never would have said, hopefully, in what we call our right mind, or in a calm mind, a peaceful mind. So those things that we do with anger that we justify, it's not okay to be angry all the time. But there are things that it is okay to be angry about. School shootings, we should be angry about that. I'd like to see somebody as angry about the injustice in the world as they are about the parking of the guy who couldn't do it right. You know, what else are we angry about? That waiter took so long to bring me my dinner. Unacceptable. I'm going to tip them nothing. That'll show them. Yeah, okay, well, how about you be angry about something that matters? Are you in that big of a rush? Are you that important that your dinner has to be there right then? We get angry about so many things, and it's because they're out of our control. And we love to have control. Jesus calls us to not take ourselves so seriously. But instead of being so over-focused on ourselves, to twist that into being more focused on Christ. Less of us and more of Him. What if instead of being so quick to anger, which He says don't do, we were quick to forgive? What if instead of being so quick to judgment and irritation and frustration, we were quick to grace and understanding and compassion? There are things that we should be angry about. I often hear people say, well, Pastor, Jesus was angry. I know how to be angry like Jesus. Do you? Jesus wasn't angry for Himself. When all of the awful things were happening to Him and He was being persecuted, He never once lashed out in anger. In fact, when the disciples reached out to fight one of the soldiers who went to cut off an ear, right? And he cut off the ear, and Jesus said, stop it. And this is a man that came to arrest him and lead him to his death. And instead of anger, he took the ear and he healed it. He healed the person that had come to deliver him to his death and begin that journey. If anybody had a right to be angry, it was him. It wasn't just. There were lies about Jesus. It wasn't right what was happening. It wasn't right what was being said. The whole thing was twisted. And yet he sought to heal the very person that came to take him away. What if we were like Christ and decided to be people who heal instead of people who hurt? What if instead of saying something to our loved ones that we know will show them, we use real strength and we restrain? What if instead of saying that next thing you really want to say because you know it's going to be saucy, what if you just said, all right, I love you, and take some time to process? How would that work? How would that work? Jesus said, don't let the sun go down on your anger. That always made me mad. Because I don't want to talk to you if you make me mad. I want to go to my room, I want to go to sleep, and in the morning when I get up, and I'll think about my meeting today. Well, that's not what Jesus calls me to. That's convenient for me. That's convenient for me. But that's not the life, the higher calling that I'm called to. I'm called to find a different source of strength. It's not in our fists. Our hands, when Tate and I first got together, our kids were smaller, and Tate would tell the children often, these hands were made for you and given to you by God, not to hurt or to hit, but to help and to love. You know, what if we did more of what God wanted us to do and less of what we wanted to do? What if we made it more about God and less about us? What if we made it more about the other person and less about us? Jesus turned the tables in the temple and he was furious. He was furious because people in the name of God were overcharging God's people in order to buy a sacrifice so that they could go into the temple and ask for forgiveness. They were taking advantage of God's people in the name of God. Now, from this pastor's perspective, there are a lot of tables in this world I'd like to overturn in the same voice. Not my place, that's God's. Jesus will turn over some tables. Just let's stand back. There are a lot of things being done in the name of Jesus that cause great harm. I should be more upset about that than I am about not getting to the city on time, or not getting my food quick enough, or not getting to watch my TV show because the internet stinks in Shawnee. Those are the things we need to think about. Instead of yelling at a child who's misbehaving, what if you sat down with them and tried to understand them? Try to just talk to them. Maybe they had a bad day. You ever had a bad day? Left your house, had a bad day, breakfast was terrible, you burnt the pancakes, and, you know. Right? We've all been there. It almost feels like I can't even make a pancake. Like, I'm just done today. Right? We've been there. We've been in those days. It's like, I'm done right now. I'm not even going to leave the house. And you go out into the world, and one person hits your trigger, and you just explode. I had a therapist a long time ago who said, Tiffany, you know, you have these trigger points. We all have these trigger points. The thing is, we don't tell each other where our lines are. And I thought that was so wise. We all have these lines that we put out. Don't cross this line, Aiden. Except I don't ever tell him what the line is. I assume that he's going to know. I assume that each of you will know what my trigger point is. And if you don't know all about me, then I'm mad at you. You see how anger wrecks things? Anger ruins relationships. God offers us love. If you really want to be strong in this world, you'll lean on love and not anger. You'll choose love over anger. You'll choose love over division. You'll look at people in the world who are different from you, even ones you don't agree with. There were lots of people I don't agree with that never, ever, ever gave me the right not to love them. Ever. God never, ever, ever gave me I was never given that right. And we'll talk about judgment next week. But there are things that are God's job, and judging people isn't one of them for me. That's not my job. God didn't give me permission to tear God's children down. And I talk to couples about that when they get married. Is it truly the person that you've chosen to share your life with, even between parents and children? As much as you love that person, God loves them more. God created them. God had plans for them. God designed them exactly the way that they are. And God loves them more than he ever will. But God is entrusting them to your care. So my job, whether Tate is telling terrible jokes or not, he is. It's to still love him as God has asked me to. My job, whether my children are teenagers and driving me up the wall or not, is to love them with everything I have. And I've come to learn at this stage in my life that when you raise teenagers, they are mean. And they hurt your feelings. And they're also very loving and cuddly and kind and beautiful and a blessing. You don't have to leave. He's like, that's it, Mom, I'm out of here. Somebody said, you know, the teenage years are how you are able to let them go. But you always love them. You always love them. No matter what they said to you, no matter when they really hurt, or they let you down, or they broke your heart, you always love them. That's what God asks us to do for all people. Don't let your heart go down with anger. Not just the sun. Don't let your heart go down with anger. You were made for so much more. Your heart was not designed to hold hatred and anger. Your heart was designed to produce and give and hold all the love you can. Will you put that James passage up there? I want to leave you again with these passages as you go out this week, because they're the words that we hang on to, the words that give us guidance. You must understand this. My beloved, let everyone be quick to listen. Man, we could listen more than we talk. Slow to speak. Slow to anger. For your anger does not produce God's righteousness. When we are in uncontrollable anger, and we are acting and speaking out of anger towards other people, we are not in the will of God. That is not what God wants for us. And that is a conviction for all of us to go home. If you are someone who struggles with anger, let's work it out. Let's get to the root of it. But when we are operating out of anger, we're not in the will of God. My prayer for you is that you're always walking to be in the will of God and the light of God and the love of God. Let us pray. Gracious and almighty God, we come before you to lay our hearts bare. Lord, you know we get angry and testy and frustrated and moody. And Lord, sometimes we justify it and we laugh about it, but you say there is no justification. You ask us to be love. Forgive us, God, when we are anything but love. Forgive us when we are anger against your children. And help us to be better. Help us to love better. It's in your name we pray.